Hello everyone, and welcome to React Knowledgeable, as well as some guests that welcome to the Shopee office. So my name is Tin. I'm working as a front-end software engineer for Shopee. So today, my talk will be about the CSS.com and JS.com EU highlights. And okay, let's start it. So the JS.com and CSS.com EU was organized with just around 3 weeks ago in Berlin. Usually the CSS.com and the JS.com will be organized together, and this year I have an opportunity to go to Berlin and join them in 3 days. So I will talk briefly about the JS.com EU. So JS.com EU is one of the largest JS.com in the world. It started in 2009, and the organizers of JS.com EU was actually inspired after they attended the JS.com US. And back to 2009, JavaScript is really, really in very early stage, and we don't have a community. As we show here, like in 2009, when we say JavaScript, most people would think of jQuery, and people can't don't think that we can do more than that with JavaScript. And at that time, because other languages like Python, they have a strong community, and already that's why the organizer of JS.com EU really want to have a contribution to the development of JavaScript community. And it's a story of the story. So JS.com EU has gone through 10 years, and over these 10 years, it actually has an impact in the development of JavaScript community. For example, on the first JS.com EU, Node.js was introduced to the world. Later on, in 2012, TypeScript was publicly introduced to the community after being used 2 years internally by Microsoft. And 1 year later, React was reintroduced at JS.com EU as well, after it has been introduced in US and inspired lots of people. And last year, at JS.com EU 2018, the creator of Node.js officially launched the demo, which is actually a new thing that we would like to fix the issues with Node.js. There's a very interesting talk about that, like 10 things that he regrets about doing with Node.js. And for the JS.com EU, it started in 2013, and from that until now, every year it will consider as a sister conference with JS.com EU. A very bad news is that this year will be the last JS.com and JS.com EU, which is a bit sad, but the organizer really do this for 10 years, and after that they did lots of things, and now the conference is so big that they cannot continue with this format anymore. So this year we have around more than 1,200 developers from more than 25 countries joining JS.com EU. So they will take a break, and maybe they come back in the near future with a new format. So I will highlight a bit some of the very interesting talk about CSS.com EU as well as JS.com EU. Because I'm not really a CSS people, I just those are the talk that I found is more relevant and maybe interesting for most of us. Due to the time constraint, I will not go through all of the talks, because I don't think that I can do better than the speakers to deliver what I want to say in the talk. I only highlight some of them. A very interesting I would like to mention is about a talk about functional CSS. So what is functional CSS? It's just a way you write CSS in two smaller class and very atomic that you can reuse everywhere. For example, for this like flex or flex direction column, this direction, I can just create a class for that property only. And the good thing of it is that it's very minimum and you can reuse the class. For example, the display flex, due to the different implementation in the browser, it has different prefix, depends on the web engine. So display flex will be auto prefix into three lines for this, for example, like this. So if we use a functional CSS, we don't have to have lots of duplication in the style sheet and can produce it as minimum as possible. And by doing this, you also don't have to worry about the rules, which rules will apply first if you shuffle the style, because every style is very atomic. And those are some of my highlights about the GSCom EU. So because this is really a big conference and most of the talk happening at the same time, so actually I didn't attend all of them, but those are my highlights about the talks. I divide them into four categories: the JavaScript in general, the front end, the Node.js one, and the others. Interesting talk. For example, they show you how to build a JavaScript engine in Rust, or explain about how ad blocker works and how the website are fighting back with ad blockers. Those are very interesting talk. And since I am a front-end developer, I will focus more on the front-end part. So these are the two talks that I would like to highlight in my presentation today, is that the problem with Node.js and the front-end developer nowadays is that how do you maintain and manage your package? So who has Yarn installed or NPM installed? Raise your hand. Okay, you're not alone, I'm one of them. So I have the pain that, for example, I work on multiple branches on features. Every time I check out to a new branch, a new feature, I have to run Yarn install again. And sometimes it takes so long, it takes like 2 or 3 minutes to install all the packages that I want. And when I check out back again, I have to run Yarn install again. Not too bad. I decided to get a cup of coffee in wait time, and I think I drink too much coffee. So it is a problem that there are two very interesting talk that they would like to solve it. So the first talk is about think. So in short, the idea is that you don't have to run Yarn install. You can move that to the runtime. So the idea is that all the packages will be lazy loaded, and one more issue with the NPM packages is that when you download a library over the network, there are many things that you are downloading together, not just the logic that you want, like the documentation, the test, the raw source code, but even actually you just need the minified version or something like that. So Ting is an effort to download what you want. For example, like it just download the entry point of that library and it cache it. And even if you check out to another branch, because it keeps a local version of the library already, so you don't have to run Yarn install, and actually it will be faster. A very interesting about thing is that the thing was introduced first, and immediately after that there is a talk about Yarn 2.0, and they have a similar idea. So thing, they want to install less packages, right? But Yarn, they want the zero installs. This will be the upcoming features for next version of Yarn. So the idea is that we will add on the files to the Git repo. You commit everything into the commit. So it sounds horrible. It's like I don't want to commit like 500 megabyte of packages into my repo, but actually because Yarn already have a block and play feature, it means that it can guarantee that one package is mapping it to one file. So with block and play and zip loading, you don't have to worry much about that. And the Yarn team actually talked to the colleagues in GitHub to mention this issue, and they say it's fine. So it's very interesting that we can wait for the upcoming release of Yarn. So yeah, this is my photo with the creator of Tink. She's a very interesting lady. And 1 minute for advertisement is that Tink is now under the repo of NPM, and they are working on it. So if you want to really, and she is the main maintainer for this thing. And if you want really to have this, you can take a look. Another thing I'm quite impressed is about the introduction to the version 1.0 version of Stencil. So what is Stencil? In short, it is a compiler for web component. The good thing about Stencil is that it has zero dependencies. So basically, Stencil is not a library. It's a compiler, provide a tiny API, which is using JSX syntax and asynchronous rendering. It will compile your source code to pure JavaScript, and it's based on the web component standard. So the reason why they build Stencil is that one thing that I like to mention here is that Stencil is created by the core team of Ionic. So the reason why they come up with this idea is that the very first version of Ionic, they built it on Angular V1. And then later, the V2 of Angular is released. And as we know, it's a totally new thing. And they had to rewrite lots of things. So that's why they come up with the idea is that to write a component in the UI, maybe it's not a good idea that you rely on the framework or library. But they would like to rely something like on the web standard, the web platform standard, like a web component is something that will always be there. And even if, and Stencil is just a compiler, it will compile your code into web component. So even if in the future Stencil is not there, you can still use it. Use your component to ship it everywhere. One interesting use case is that maybe, for example, in Shopee right now, we are using React.js and we have lots of utilities and UI component that we would like to share. But think about it. For example, in the future, if we don't use React.js anymore, we use something like the X framework or something, or a library, it means that all our library cannot be used anymore, right? We have to rewrite it. But if we use something like this, we can just get that component and use it everywhere, as long as it supports a web standard. So yeah, this is, so this year, they officially introduced the 1.0 version of Stencil in JSConf. And yeah, I actually in this talk also, the guy with the red t-shirt. Yeah, just in front of the speaker. Yeah, you can see me in the talk. So this is really selling point that the Ionic team is trying to sell is that since it relies on web component and it has zero dependencies, you can build a very to-do MVC at very small size. So the small size is really a selling point for Stencil. However, Stencil is still a young library. I think it's we can give it a try with a smaller scale, and they don't really recommend us to use it as a framework, but rather to use it as a way to generate the component rather than use it as a framework for your whole big app. So Ionic team uses this a lot. They use it, the Stencil, to build the UI component that can be reusable. Yeah, and I think I have covered some of the very highlight of the talks that I found is more relevant to me and maybe interesting to us. So for the next part, I would like to highlight something. It's why should we as developers should go to conference? Is it really so? Because over 2 years, I attended quite a number of conferences and lots of people ask me, why do you do that? Is it really useful or just a waste of time and money? Or you just want to travel? So this is my answer. Okay, I will highlight a bit about me. I joined Shopee in July 2017, exactly 2 years ago, less than 2 years ago, I guess. And I attending the React Europe last year. And this year I was fortunate to have the opportunity to attend the Google I/O in Mountain View and the Gizcom EU just this month. So it means I have less than 2 years of working full time. Yeah, and I have attended like quite a lot, a number of famous conferences. So the first reason is that it is a chance for you to meet people, the core people of doing things like you can contribute to the standard of the open web, like at conference like GSCOM EU this year. You can have a chance to talk to the people of the TC39 panel and you can talk to them. And why you need to contribute to this thing? Because if you wait until a spec is done and implemented by the browser and you look at it and you say it's rubbish, it's too late for you to say so. So going to conference is the fastest way that you can meet those people. And let's say you have a request. You say, I think I have a use case that can be useful. Then you can talk to them and they can propose you some way if you really wanted to write this request, because everything is ongoing. So I actually talked to the Mozilla team. I asked, I talked to them that this year I attended the Google I/O and I see Chrome is implementing the lazy loading for image. But I don't see any plans for Mozilla Firefox yet. They have any ongoing process on that. So it's a chance for you to tell them that I want this thing. I want this implementation. And yeah. So I think what I really think is that because we are for the JS in general, in specific, because I'm not sure about other platforms. So it's really an open standard and you can truly contribute to it. Technology is changing and you can help to to shape what it will be in the future. So either you are part of it or you are left behind and you cannot complain that this sucks, this doesn't work. One more thing I would like to highlight is that this is the statistics in 2019. On average, every day, there will be more than 1 million new internet users. And where do they come from? They do not come from US or Europe. They are coming from developing countries. They come from China, they come from India, they come from Southeast Asia. So we as a developer in the developing countries in Southeast Asia, we should be a representative. Because the problem we are doing every day here is the problem that other developers all around the world is trying to solve. And it is also a chance for you to tell the others about you and your work. So I take this slide at this year Google I/O. And actually Shopee was featured is one of the talk about performance. And as you see here that it's really true that a good example of performance or user experience can be found everywhere. And so maybe the problem you are solving every day, optimization issue you are working every day, the bug you are fixing every day actually has an impact. And the other is also looking for the answer for this. So please go out and share with them, discuss about the solution. Because eventually, right, for big companies like if like Google, Facebook, everywhere, they are shifting to the new market, to developing countries. That's why recently, like Facebook, they are doing very interesting project about in India or something. Okay, it sounds interesting. I would like to go to conference now, but how if it's really expensive? For example, like it's not really affordable for me to go to US or Europe to attend a conference. I really want it, but it's a bit expensive. What can you do? The first thing is that ask for your company for help. It's I think the easiest way. As a Shopee, we have this kind of financial support as a sales development for employees. And if your company cannot help with that, you can ask for the organizers. Most of the conference, they will kind of donations, and they can have the budget for to help people from really disadvantaged background, or those that they think that you can bring some values to the conferences. And in the worst case, if you cannot go very far, you can go to a local meetup, like the meetup we're going to have in Shopee after my talk. Yeah. So I will say a bit about GSCOM EU. So I will use this slide to show my thanks a lot for the GSCOM EU organizer, because they have the scholarship. I applied for that and they give me the scholarship. I really appreciate that. And it's like, what I want to say, it's like if you want to go and you need help, just approach the organizers. Actually, they would like you to come, because I wrote them about a story. I grew up in the countryside part of Vietnam. In my childhood, right, what I see is that every day I ride a bicycle like 5 km to school. I see the rice field, the buffalo along the way. And I managed to find a way to Singapore to study in Singapore, and then I find a way to US. And later on, I would like to go out to the conference like in Europe and so many places. So yeah, and this is the end of my presentation, and thanks a lot for your listening. But I think it's not the end yet. I believe that next year, if I have attending an interesting conference and I have something to share, I will have another sharing soon. Yeah, thanks. Sorry? So what Mozilla said is that they are working on it, and I asked very specific reason is that why in Chrome the way they implement it is now is that even I specify the size and the width of my image, they still download the first 2 kilobytes of the image. Yeah, it's I raise a use case is that maybe like it's something that they should consider. I like if I need a way to specify that I don't need to download it at all. I can specify some attributes for them to do that. And they say that they will consider. And but you know what? But the point is that you want to talk to them, and maybe if they don't really do that, maybe I will create a pull request for them in GitHub, raising that concern. Yeah.
Any other questions?
So, what's your next conference that you're going to go?
I don't know yet.
I have a question.
Okay.
So when you go to conference, you talk to people, right? What's your conversation style?
Usually, I will tell where I come from and what I work on. Like I say that I usually start when I work for an e-commerce website. And we say, oh, what is the company? I say, Shopee, the largest e-commerce in Southeast Asia. Yeah. And yeah, it's like, and I talk about the work. I work every day. I spend a lot of time on a server render. And yeah, they ask me, and then actually they ask me some questions about server render because they are doing that also. So for example, I talked to one of about a stencil also, because I was impressed by the talk about stencil. So I stay a bit and I asked some questions like, can you use it in large scale or any big corporation is doing it? And actually one of the engineers in from Spain, he said that he works for a bank and they're using that. A bank in Spain. Yeah, and they use it a lot in their main website. And that's why I'm really surprised. And I asked him, how you do that? And you have seen any issues? So far he said that they don't face any serious issues. Yeah.
Any other questions? If not, then thank you.
Thank you.